Although pesticides can be useful, they also can be dangerous if used carelessly or not stored properly. The most effective way to reduce risks posed by pesticides is to use non-chemical control methods to reduce or eliminate pest problems. But if pesticides are used, then you need to know how to properly store, mix, load, and apply pesticides. Accidents happen, so you need to know what to do if you have a spill. I'm Dr. DeBusk, and this video discusses some important aspects of pesticide safety. The first topic I will discuss is pesticide storage. If you store pesticides for your operation, this storage must be properly constructed and maintained to prevent problems or an expensive cleanup in the event of an accident. The best way to minimize storage problems is to minimize the amount you store. Purchasing only small amounts that you can use quickly is the best approach for many turf and landscape management professionals. If you have to store pesticides, follow these guidelines. Design and build pesticide storage structures to keep pesticides secure and isolated from the surrounding environment. Store pesticides in a roofed concrete or metal structure with a lockable door. Keep pesticides in a separate facility or at least in a locked area, separate from areas used to store other materials, especially fertilizers, feed, and seed. Do not store pesticides near flammable materials, hot work, such as welding or grinding, or in shop areas. Do not allow smoking in pesticide storage areas. Store personal protective equipment, PPE, where it is easily accessible in an emergency. However, do not store PPE in the pesticide storage area since that may make it unavailable during an emergency. Check the label and the safety data sheet, the SDS, to determine the required safety equipment for each chemical used in the operation. Keep a written pesticide inventory and the SDS file for the chemicals on site. Do not store this information in the pesticide storage room itself. Remember that PPE is specified for normal application and handling activities. Regular PPE may not be protective in emergency situations such as fires or reactions with other spilled chemicals. Depending on the product stored and the quantity, you may need to register the facility with the Florida Department of Community Affairs and your local emergency response agency. Check with your pesticide dealer about community right-to-know laws for the materials that you purchase. An emergency response plan should be in place and familiar to personnel before an emergency occurs, such as lightning strike, fire, or hurricane. Individuals conducting emergency pesticide cleanups should be properly trained under the requirements of the Federal Occupational Safety and Health Administration, OSHA. For reporting chemical spills, see the section on spill reporting requirements later in this video. Do not store large quantities of pesticides for long periods. Adopt the first in, first out principle, using the oldest products first to ensure that the product shelf life does not expire. Store pesticides in their original containers. Do not put pesticides in containers that might cause children or others to mistake them for food or drink. Wouldn't someone be in trouble if they didn't see the pesticide written on the side of that whiskey bottle? Keep the containers securely closed and inspect them regularly for splits, tears, breaks, or leaks. All pesticide containers should be labeled. Arrange pesticide containers so that the labels are clearly visible and make sure that the labels are legible. Refasten all loose labeling using non-water soluble glue or sturdy transparent packaging tape. Do not refasten labels with rubber bands, which quickly rot and easily break, or non-transparent tapes such as duct tape or masking tape, which may obscure important product caution statements or label directions for product use. If a label is damaged, immediately request a replacement from the pesticide dealer or formulator. As a temporary supplement to disfigured or badly damaged labels, fasten a baggage tag to the container handle. On the tag, write the product name, formulation, concentration of the active ingredients, signal word, the statement "keep out of the reach of children," and the date of purchase. If there is any question about the contents of the container, set it aside for proper disposal. Dry bags should be raised on pallets to ensure that they do not get wet. Do not store liquid materials above dry materials. Store flammable pesticides separately from non-flammable pesticides. Segregate herbicides, insecticides, and fungicides to prevent cross-contamination and minimize the potential for misapplication. Cross-contaminated pesticides often cannot be applied in accordance with the labels of each of the products. This may make it necessary to dispose of cross-contaminated materials as waste and could require the services of a consultant or hazardous waste contractor. Use shelving made of plastic or reinforced metal. Keep metal shelving painted unless made of stainless steel to avoid corrosion. If you use wood shelving, paint it with an enamel or waterproof paint to minimize any absorption of spilled pesticide materials. It is best to replace wood shelving with metal or plastic. Construct floors of seamless metal and concrete sealed with a chemical-resistant paint. For concrete, use a water-cement ratio no higher than 0.45 to 1 by weight and leave a rough finish to provide adhesion for the sealant. Equip the floor with a continuous curb to retain spilled materials. While a properly sealed sump may be included to help recover spilled materials, do not install a drain as it can release spilled material into the environment. If you have a drain in the storage area, seal it as soon as possible to prevent uncontrolled releases. Provide sloped ramps at the entrance to allow handcarts to safely move material in and out of the storage area. When designing the facility, keep in mind that temperature extremes during storage may reduce safety and affect pesticide efficacy. Provide automatic exhaust fans and an emergency wash area. The emergency wash area should be outside the storage building. Local fire and electrical codes may require explosion-proof lighting and fans. The light fan switches should be outside the building, and both switches should be turned on before people enter and should remain on until after they have left the building. Plans and specifications for pesticide storage buildings are available from several sources, including the U.S. Department of Agriculture Natural Resources Conservation Service, NRCS, the Midwest Plant Service, and the UFIFAS Extension Bookstore. These organizations' publications also contain recommended management practices for pesticide storage facilities. Note that canceled, suspended, or unusable pesticides must be disposed of properly. Storage for long periods can lead to leaking containers or other costly problems. The Florida Department of Environmental Protection, FDEP, and the Florida Department of Agricultural and Consumer Science, FDACS, operate a program called Operation Clean Sweep for the free disposal of these materials. For more information, call the toll-free number on this brochure shown on the slide. If this program is not available, a licensed waste disposal contractor should do the disposal. Another safety concern is the mixing and loading. In most cases, the mixing and loading of pesticides into application equipment should be done adjacent to the application site. If chemicals are routinely mixed and loaded at a shop or storage site, spilled material can accumulate and expensive cleanup procedures may be required. Florida law requires an air gap or back siphoning device between the water supply and the application equipment to prevent backflow into the water supply. Never submerge the end of a water supply hose in a tank. This can lead to costly contamination of a water supply. Use extreme caution when handling concentrated chemicals. Spills could result in expensive hazardous waste cleanup. It is important to understand how mixing and loading procedures can pollute vulnerable groundwater and surface water supplies if conducted improperly and at the wrong site. Locate operations well away from groundwater wells in areas where runoff may carry spilled pesticides into surface water bodies. Areas around public water supply wells should receive special consideration and may be designated as wellhead protection areas. Before mixing or loading pesticides in such areas, consult with state and local government officials to determine if special restrictions apply. To prevent problems when mixing chemicals on site, use a mixing tray or portable pad to avoid spillage that could be transported to non-targeted areas. Should a chemical spill onto the mixing tray, the material should then be rinsed into the applicator equipment and used according to the product label. For your own safety, always use all personal protective equipment required by the label. The following BMPs should be used for mixing and loading pesticides. Mix the pesticide and load the spreader or sprayer carefully to avoid spills. Mix and load pesticides on an impervious mix and load pad with provisions for collecting and reusing spilled or waste materials. Use excess pesticide mixtures on a site that is specified on the label. Consider closed systems for loading and mixing. Triple rinse containers, pour the rinsate into the spray tank, and use the excess according to the product label. What happens if you have a spill? Clean up spills as soon as possible. Unmanaged spills may quickly move into surface waters and injure plants and animals. It is essential to be prepared for major or minor spills. The sooner you can contain, absorb, and dispose of a spill, the less chance there is that it will cause harm. Always use the appropriate personal protective equipment as indicated on the SDS and the label for a chemical. In addition, follow the following four steps. Control actively spilling or leaking materials by setting the container upright, plugging leaks, or shutting the valve. Contain the spilled material using barriers and absorbent material. For small spills, use kitty litter, vermiculite, shredded newspaper, absorbent pillows, clean sand, or pads. Use dikes to direct large spills away from ditches, storm drains, ponds, sinkholes, or woods. You can also use commercially available products to absorb spilled materials. Collect spilled material, absorbents, and leaking containers and place them in a secure, properly labeled container. Some contaminated materials could require disposal as hazardous waste. Store the containers of spilled material until they can be applied as a pesticide or appropriately disposed of. Small liquid spills may be cleaned up by using an absorbent such as cat litter, diluting it with soil, and then applying the absorbent to the target site as a pesticide in accordance with the label instructions. Comply with all applicable federal, state, and local regulations regarding spill response training for employees, spill reporting requirements, spill containment, and cleanup. Clean spill cleanup equipment available when handling pesticides or their containers. If a spill occurs for a pesticide covered by certain state and federal laws, you may need to report any accidental release if the spill quantity exceeds the reportable quantity of active ingredients specified in the law. Very few of the pesticides routinely used in landscape management are covered under these requirements. A complete list of hazardous materials, including pesticides and reportable quantities, is available by calling 850-413-9970. This table provides reportable quantities for several common landscape pesticides, but it is your responsibility to determine if a pesticide you use has a reportable quantity. The list in the table should not be used as a substitute for the list provided by calling the telephone number. Wash water from pesticide application equipment must be managed properly, since it could contain pesticide residues. Ensuring that no pesticide spills occur on the vehicle by mixing all pesticides over mixing trays eliminates potential pesticide hazards. Sweep any granular products that have spilled onto the vehicle or non-targeted areas into label bags for later use. Wash the vehicle in a designated wash area. The water hose should have an on-off valve and a water-reducing nozzle. Use the least amount of water possible to wash the equipment adequately. These practices prevent unwanted pesticide residues from being washed onto non-targeted areas. Avoid conducting such washing in the vicinity of wells or surface water bodies. Public laws require immediate notification of the appropriate U.S. governmental agency when oil or hazardous substances are discharged. The law states any such person who fails to notify immediately such agency of such discharge shall, upon conviction, be fined not more than $10,000 or imprisoned for not more than 1 year or both. Under Florida statutes, any owner or operator of a facility who has knowledge of any release of a hazardous substance from a facility in a quantity equal to or exceeding the reportable quantity, see the SDS sheet, in a 24-hour period shall immediately notify the state warning point. The owner or operator having a discharge of petroleum products exceeding 25 gallons on a pervious surface or any amount in a water body must report such discharge to the Florida Department of Environmental Protection or the state warning point. The following information should be reported following a spill, including names and addresses, date and time of discharge, name of substance, location and cause of discharge, size of affected area, actions taken, and agency contacted. We're going to shift gears and talk about unintentional discharges to the environment through drift. The drift of spray from pesticide applications can expose people, plants, and animals and the environment to pesticide residues that can cause health and environmental effects and property damage. Pesticide use is poorly understood by the public, which causes anxiety and sometimes overreaction to a situation. Even the application of fertilizers or biological pesticides like BT or pheromones can be perceived as a danger to the general public. Drift can lead to litigation, financially damaging court costs, and appeals to restrict or ban the use of pesticides. Urbanization, including residential subdivisions, assisted living facilities, hospitals, and schools are sensitive areas that heighten the need for drift mitigation measures to be taken by applicators of pesticides, particularly in areas where children and the elderly are present. Drift can be defined simply as the unintentional airborne movement of pesticides to non-target areas. The goal of all pesticide applications is to reach a specific target and remain there. Not all drift may be harmful or illegal. Because some drift can occur with any application, the laws focus on preventing substantial drift. How much a pesticide may drift and whether it's harmful depends on the interrelated factors that can be complex. Where significant drift does occur, it can damage or contaminate sensitive crops, poison bees or other pollinators, pose health risks to humans and animals, and contaminate soil and water in adjacent areas. Applicators are legally responsible for the damages resulting from the off-target movement of pesticides. It is impossible to eliminate drift totally, but it is possible to reduce it to a legal level. Ultimately, it is the applicator's job to determine if conditions are conducive for drift to occur and to take precautions against it. To minimize concerns to neighbors and the environment, applicators must recognize sensitive areas around each landscape before beginning an application. By exercising sound judgment regarding both equipment and weather factors relative to each application, applicators can minimize drift potential in nearly every case. Follow label directions. If there are specific conditions spelled out on a product label in regards to drift, they should be the first concern. Know the right conditions. If winds are blowing towards a sensitive area, do not spray at any wind speed. Ideally, winds should be in the range of 3 to 9 miles per hour. Generally, pesticides should not be sprayed when winds exceed 10 miles per hour. Use caution when winds are light and variable, especially when applications are to be made near susceptible vegetation. Be aware that very calm conditions could indicate the presence of a temperature inversion, especially during the early morning. Inversions favor pesticide drift. Also use special caution when relative humidity is low and when temperatures are high. Drift is much more likely during the hottest part of the day, as those conditions are conducive for drops to evaporate, form smaller droplets, or drift off target. Keep application records. Keep records of air temperature, relative humidity, wind speed, and wind direction. These records, as well as equipment and application information, may be very helpful in dealing with drift-related litigation. Hopefully you learned about several aspects of pesticide safety, including pesticide storage, mixing and loading, pesticide spill management, and drift management.